Welcome to my presentation on leakage-resilient value comparison with application to message authentication. This is a joint work with Christoph de Bruynig. Typically, when we want to prove security of a scheme, we consider black box security. So we've got a certain mode, for instance, counter mode based on AES or any other mode. And then we consider an attacker. And this attacker can make queries to the scheme, and then it gets certain responses. It can make a certain amount of queries, and every query comes with a response. And in the end, the attacker has to make a decision or a forgery. In practice, however, there's more going on. So if you implement the scheme could have very good black box security, but if we implement the scheme, there might additionally be leakage. This could, for instance, be power consumption or electromagnetic radiation. And this leakage could potentially help the attacker in getting extra information about secret data, such as a secret state or a key. There are two ways to mitigate this problem. One way is protection at the implementation level. The idea is that you take a very efficient scheme, a very good black box secure scheme, and once implemented, you implement it using masking or hiding. In this way, you kind of make sure that the attacker cannot get any useful leakage. Typically, these masking approaches are design specific and they could be expensive. The alternative approach is protection at the mode level. In this case, the mode is made in a slightly more involved, slightly more expensive and inefficient way, but in such a way that when implemented, it never gives or it barely gives any useful leakage to the attacker. And the difference between these two approaches becomes very clear if you look at permutation-based message authentication code. The most efficient way of doing permutation-based message authentication code is undoubtedly the full state keyed sponge. And here you see a simplified picture of this full state keyed sponge, FKS. And the idea is that we take an n-bit permutation and then we glue together the key with the message to get the first state. This state is then permuted to get a new secret state to which the second message block is added. You permute the third message block up to the last message block. You make one more permutation call and then you truncate to get a sufficient tag length, a tag T of a desired length. And this is an extremely efficient scheme. Most importantly, you kind of compress n bits at a time, where n is the size of the permutation. On the downside, it doesn't get any mode level protection against side channel attacks. So this means that when you implement this, you need to have implementation level protection. You need to protect the permutation P. And note that in particular, you have many secret states in this evaluation. So the state gets initialized with the key and the message. This is a secret state. The attacker should not learn the key. Then you permute, you get a new secret state. And if the attacker learns that state, it can basically track back and obtain the key. So you also need to protect all the states in the meantime. An alternative way of doing permutation-based message authentication is SUX. And SUX is a suffix-keyed sponge. So it already originated from Bertoni et al. In 2011 with a very simplified version of this. This is the general version that Christoph and I proved leakage-resilient 2 years ago. And the idea is that the key is only processed in the end. So the first part is a keyless part, where you basically plainly hash the key as a sponge, using R bits at a time. As a matter of fact, you cannot do full state absorption here because then the attacker might get a collision in the hash part. But this is a keyless hashing part. And only then, at the end, after compressing all the message blocks, you blend in the key using some function G. This gives a new secret state where you can make one more permutation call and then you truncate to get the tag. This scheme is secure under the random permutation model, even if the G is an XOR. However, XOR is not really leakage resilient, but we also proved that this scheme is leakage resilient if G and P leak up to lambda bits of secrecy per evaluation. And it's important to note that in this case, well, you don't do full state absorption. But on the upside, the number of the number of evaluations of secret states is limited. And you barely evaluate the same secret state every time, because every time you have a new message, you very likely end up with a new state here. And this means that we GMP need to be protected in some way. They need to leak up to lambda bits of secrecy per evaluation. But we only need SPA security, basically. So we need a lighter protection of these primitives, and we still get a leakage resilient scheme. But this is so far so good. This is a message authentication code that we proved leakage resilient. But how does a typically verify attack? This is just tag generation, basically. But for tag verification, the typical way of doing this, and this is also how it's done in SOX, is that if an attacker comes with a message and a guest tag, in order to verify the tag, the typical way is to simply recompute SOX on input of the key in the message, to compute the original tag, and simply do a value comparison. So you compare T star with T. If they're equal, you return 1, otherwise you return 0. But SOX is leakage resilient. It achieves very good security even in the implementation setting. But verification might still leak information about T, and if the attacker gets sufficient leakage of T, it might actually succeed in making a tag forgery. More broadly seen, if you look at the leakage resilience of message authentication codes and authenticated encryption schemes, the leakage resilience analysis is usually centered around the design of the schemes and not so much about the stack verification. The stack verification is simply left out of scope. It's assumed that the stack verification is then done, is protected at the implementation level. But this looks rather odd. So we do, as designers, we do effort to make a efficient scheme, an efficient as possible scheme that is leakage resilient, but then you still need implementation level protection for the tag verification. And if this MAC or authenticated encryption scheme already uses some protected primitives, why can't we just reuse those for verification? And this is where this work centers around. So we do a formal analysis of leakage resilient value comparison. And first I will talk a little bit about the model of leakage resilient value comparison, but maybe a bit pedantically, I will start with the black box value comparison, a security model for black box value comparison. And this security model is rather artificial. It's a bit contrived, but it gives a good impression of what we want and what we get with leakage resilience. So consider the following security game. We've got an oracle O, and this oracle is given mu random t-bit targets, t1 to t mu. And then we've got an attacker A, an adversary A that plays a game with the oracle. So the attacker can make a certain amount of queries. These queries are of the form J T star. And as a response, it gets a 0 or a 1 back. Presumably 1 if the tag verification succeeds, and 0 if the verification does not succeed. And the attacker wins if it ever receives a 1. That's a typical security model for a black box value comparison. And in the black box setting, the plain value verification works. So we can define this oracle, we can simply take this function as oracle. The function gets its input jt star, and it simply compares tj with t star. If this is equal, it returns 1, otherwise it returns 0, and this is what the brackets mean in this case. And one can actually prove that in this setting, if the attacker makes Q queries, its success probability is at most Q over 2 to the power T. But this is black box security, and in the leaky setting, the attacker might obtain extra information. Every oracle evaluation might leak information about the secret target's T. And in this case, plain target verification does not work. It fails. Because if we take this same plain target verification, what we see is that the oracle might leak information lambda. In fact, it might leak, say, up to lambda bits of information about tj for every evaluation. And this means that after around t divided by lambda queries, the attacker might, in the worst case, have obtained the entire value tj. And in this case, a value comparison succeeds trivially. So we need to do something smarter. We need to have a more sophisticated Oracle O. And this is what I'll do later, but before going to these designs, I will make a slightly more generalization of the model. And in this model, we not only take random T-bit targets, but we also take salts. More detailed, again, we have this Oracle O, and this Oracle, as before, gets as input mu random T-bit targets T1 up to T mu. In addition, we have mu salts S1 up to S mu, S bit salts, which are coupled to T. So S1 will be coupled to T1, S2 will be coupled to T2, etc. These salts are also given to the adversary, so they need not be unique. The salts are, in principle, in this model, they are in principle unique, but they need not be. You can also take random salts. You can actually omit the salts with a slight security loss, but it turns out that in many practical applications, salts are present anyway, in one way or another, and we can just as well use them. And now the attacker plays the game. So O is some verification oracle defined typically based on a random permutation or a block cipher or any cryptographic primitive. And the attacker can make attempts of the form JT star, and it gets its response a 0 or a 1. A additionally obtains leakage for every evaluation. And we model this non-adaptively. So we consider the following leakage. We assume that every cryptographic primitive within the Oracle O may leak lambda bits of information non-adaptively. So this means that if this primitive is evaluated twice on the same input, the same leakage will be leaked. In addition, a plain value comparison, a comparison of two values, so this equal sign with the question mark, might leak up to lambda bits of information about the values, again non-adaptively. So if the same values are compared two times, the same leakage will be obtained by the attacker. And in this model, we present two, or in fact four, schemes, four value comparison schemes. And the first one is PVP, for permutation-based value comparison. So let P be an n-bit permutation. This may be a secret permutation, for instance, a yes with a secret key. It may be a public permutation, for instance, the catch-up permutation or the permutation used in SHA-3. Then we define value comparison as follows. So on input of an index J and a guess value T star, the attacker wants to compare TJ with T star. But instead of plain comparison between TJ and T star, we do a process comparison. So we first take the permutation on input of the jth salt concatenated with the jth tag and filled with zeros. So we have SJ, TJ, and zeros. This value is permuted. At the same time, we take the same salt and the guessed tag T star, and we permute it. And instead of doing a comparison between T and T star, we compare the first U bits of the output, capital U versus capital U star. And these are the two values that are compared. And we prove that PVP gives a leakage resilient value comparison function. And intuitively, this is rather clean. It's a clean way of doing this. Note that the attacker might learn a leakage. So what are the leakage values in this, the secret values in this case? The secret values that the attacker would like to guess is T, TJ technically, and UJ. But TJ might leak information, but it will only leak information once. It's only evaluated once by the cryptographic permutation P. But it could be evaluated multiple times, but this is always under the same salt and the same tag. And as the leakage is non-adaptively, this will always give the same leakage. The bottom line is that the attacker learns that most lambda bits of leakage of this T bit value T. The value comparison might leak information repeatedly. The attacker might try different guesses T star. And this means that the value comparison between U, J and U star might leak multiple times for the same value U, J. So in the end, the attacker might get the entire U, J. But this is not a problem. Even if the attacker knows U, or U, J in this case, it must still make to make a successful fortree or value comparison, must still accidentally hit U by the cryptographic permutation. And this happens with a small probability. To instantiate, we have two options. So one of them is to take a public permutation, for instance, the catch-up permutation. It doesn't need to be a 1600-bit catch-up permutation. You can also take a 400-bit catch-up permutation. The security result holds under the assumption that T, the size of the tag, the target values, and U, the size of the sub-target value, are much smaller than N. In principle, in practice, this is not a problem because N is typically large enough. If you take the 400-bit catch-up permutation, you have N is 400. And this approach is actually very similar to an earlier suggestion of the designers by ISAP, one of the submissions to the NIST lightweight crypto competition. Alternatively, one takes a secret permutation P. This could be AES with a secret key. In this case, we don't have any limitation on T and U. For instance, U can be equal to N. We actually get a slightly better bound. But on the downside, if you take AES with a secret key, you have additional secret material, namely the key. And this also needs to be protected at the implementation level. The second scheme we introduce is TPVP, for tweakable permutation-based value processing. And in this case, one takes a tweakable permutation, or which could be a public or a secret tweakable permutation. A secret tweakable permutation is basically a tweakable block cipher. So a typical example would be that one takes, for instance, the skinny tweakable block ciphers, block cipher with an n-bit block size and an r-bit tweak. And then one either makes a secret variant with a secret key or a public variant by taking a constant key. And in this case, the value comparison is similar, with the difference that the salt and the tag are not, the target value are not glued together, but instead the salt is input as tweak value to the tweakable permutation in both the real target value T and the guessed target value T prime. Likewise, TPVP gives a leakage resilient value comparison scheme, and the same conditions on T and U apply. As a matter of fact, it's worth noting that TPVP with a secret tweakable permutation, effectively with a secret tweakable block cipher, was used in Spook. And Spook was one other leakage resilient submission to the NIST lightweight cryptography competition. So far so good, these are rather isolated primitives, but we can use them to make a MEC function leakage resilient in its verification. And to show this, we exemplified this with SUX. So we took SUX from one of the first slides, and we glue it together with PVP. And this gives what we call STP, or SUX then PVP. In this case, SUX is exactly SUX as before. This gives a tag, and this tag will be the target value in the permutation-based value processing function. And as salt, we take the outer part of the hashing right before, in SUX, you go to the secret part. So the salt is taken from the keyless computation of SUX. And it's not necessarily unique, but it is sufficiently random. And it's also non-secret to the adversary. So it perfectly fits the security model. And we prove that leakage resilience of STP follows from the leakage resilience of SUX and the leakage resilience of PVP. The downside is that in order to compose this in a black box manner, we use independent cryptographic primitives. So for SUX, we use an n-bit permutation P, also a function G. PVP is also based on an n-bit permutation, but it must be independent in order for us to be able to compose the scheme. So we take P prime. In practice, you can take permutations with different round constants, for instance. But we also have, to show that you can also use the same primitive, we also introduced HaFuFu, which stands for hash then function then function. So you take a cryptographic hash function and a secret pseudo-random function, and that composes to the MEC, or basically a PRF. It's a very well-established way of making a MEC function, to simply take a hash function on the input and make a pseudo-random function evaluation to get a tag. But now we use the same function f for a value comparison. So the tag goes into the value comparison, And in addition, we take the salt, and again, the salt comes from the keyless computation right after the hashing. So you take the s leftmost bits, and this is the salt. The salt goes into f together with the target value, and also it goes into f together with the guessed value t star. And leakage resilience of Hafufu is basically is the same as before. You get a comparable bound, a comparable analysis, but the difference is that because we use the same primitive for the PRF part or the MAC part and the PVP part, the value processing part, you need a dedicated security proof. So to conclude, we see that value comparison plays a very prominent role in tag verification for message authentication codes for authenticated encryption schemes. And even in the NIST lightweight cryptography competition, there were two schemes that actually actively thought about this. There are many other applications. You can think, for instance, of fault countermeasures, where you do multiple evaluations of multiple computations of a value, and then you compare the results. And our schemes show that you can do value comparison very efficiently in a leakage resilient way by using existing resources. There's one point to notice, actually, and that is that process value comparison, the way we do it right now, leads to a slightly larger success probability. So if you go back to PVP, and you see that the attacker has a successful forgery if it either guesses the value TJ correctly, or if there is an accidental collision here. So even if the target value is incorrect, the attacker might still get a success here with value comparison. Effectively, this gives a factor 2 in the security loss. This means that you lose one bit of security. The attacker has a twice as high success probability. And we think this is a very modest price to pay, recalling that both implementation level countermeasures as mode level countermeasures often come at a price. So leakage resilient designs are often already a bit less efficient. We saw this when we compared FKS with SUX. And this is only one bit of security loss. And this presentation only gave the very high level idea. In the paper, you can actually find the exact security analysis, also the security assumptions under which the analysis is done, and more on the relaxation of the salt. This concludes my presentation. So thank you for your attention.